All right, once again, I am Anna Galletti, and we are now going to do part two of the brain anatomy lectures. All right, so in the previous video, we looked at the cerebrum and the diencephalon, and now we're going to look at the brainstem and cerebellum. So let's do the cerebellum first, because it's just one thing. So right here is the cerebellum. What does it do? Some conscious, precise motor control processes info from motor cortex. It's all you need to know, all right? Now, this section that's colored is the brainstem, all in here, right here, okay? So this is your diencephalon, and this is the brainstem. So you think of it as the stem that's going from the brain to the spinal cord, and the spinal cord is right there. So when you use your imagination, what I want you to imagine is that this is where the foramen magnum is. And you should all remember that that is the hole that goes through the base of the occipital of your skull, okay? And when you look at the spinal cord versus the brainstem, you'll notice that there's a dimensional change. So this is narrower than this. This is fatter up in here, okay? Now this section of the brainstem right here is called the medulla oblongata, okay? And then we get up into this section here, which is called the midbrain, all right? So you've got your functions for midbrain and your functions for the medulla oblongata. Please try to remember also that the cranial nerves are located on the midbrain. And then this thing that looks like an apple sitting on the front is called the pons, conduction of fiber tracts, regulation of breathing, okay? Now we've got some special features. Coming down here, you have your cerebral aqueduct, and then that widens out into the fourth ventricle right here, and then that becomes the spinal canal that goes down the very center, okay? All right, next slide. All right, continuing with the brainstem, but focusing in on the special features of the midbrain. We have, so remember, your eyes are here, and this is the posterior or back of your head, okay? This is where your ponytail goes. Because hopefully you don't have it in the front of your head, because that's weird. So on the anterior aspect, we have a bulge, and this is called the cerebral peduncles. You've got a right and a left, but when we look at a cross-section, you'll see there are areas filled with a structure called substantia nigra, which is really important because it's where we produce a lot of dopamine, and if it gets damaged, if it stops producing sufficient dopamine, you get Parkinson's disease, okay? Now on the posterior, I have this thing that looks like camel bumps. So there's the bumps of the camel, here's the neck of the camel, and then just imagine that there's a head right there, okay? The back bump is the superior colliculus. So colliculi is plural, colliculus is singular. So all you need to know, reflex visual and eye tracking, all right? And then you've got the inferior colliculus, which is for auditory and startle reflex. So this is the superior, ooh, need a different color. Superior colliculus, and that is the inferior colliculus, okay? All right, so now we've taken the brainstem and we've done a cross section, a transverse section through it, okay? Like you've cut the head off, and you can see better the cerebral peduncle. So you've got a right and a left, okay? And in there we have this area that shades really darkly because it's filled with melanin. And melanin in this case is a precursor of dopamine. So you get a ton of dopamine being made in the substantia nigra of the cerebral peduncle, okay? Also in these areas you have the corticospinal tracts, which we'll very briefly mention when we get to the spinal cord, okay? Another structure, you've got these things that look like big eyes, that's the red nucleus. Now all of these areas that are not white, these are types of gray matter, so these are variations on the basal nuclei, okay? I've got the origin for cranial nerve 3, oculomotor nerve, and then you can see right here the cerebral aqueduct, which is full of CSF, cerebral spinal fluid, and then because of where this was cut, I am seeing basal nuclei that corresponds to the superior colliculus. If it had been cut more inferiorly, you would have had the inferior colliculus. All right, next slide. All right, so now we are gonna look at the ventricles and cerebral spinal fluid. So I think of the ventricles as cavities filled with CSF. This can be difficult to visualize because all the pictures that you see, well, they do them in these pretty blue colors. And it looks like they're solid, but it's not. That's liquid. The blue is representing liquid. And if you take away the liquid, you've got an empty cavity. Okay? Now, I'm going to have a lateral ventricle here and a lateral ventricle here. There's one in each cerebral hemisphere. Over here, we've got the sagittal view or the lateral view, and you can see the lateral ventricle right there. Now, you are going to connect the two lateral ventricles to the third ventricle here and to here. Okay, they drain into that. Now notice, right here, I've got a spot that's not blue. That is your thalamic hesion. That's where the right and left lobes of the thalamus adhesion kiss, okay? Then the third ventricle is going to empty into this structure here, and it's going to go down into your fourth ventricle here and here. Now we do have little interventricular foramina that go out to the sides, all right? And then, where's the cerebral aqueduct? Why did the arrow not make it? The cerebral aqueduct is basically here and here. I should change the color. So here's the cerebral aqueduct. So it goes from lateral ventricle to third ventricle, to cerebral aqueduct to fourth ventricle, okay? And then the fourth ventricle is going to empty into the spinal canal that goes down the center of your spinal cord. All right, so right there. So the red arrows that I'm now making blue show you the direction that the cerebral spinal fluid can flow. All right, so this picture is from your Saladin book, or maybe it's from the McKinley book. Anyway, you've got it in here now. And it somehow, when it converted this over to this file, it totally messed up these numbers. So just do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, okay? And then that will correspond to these numbers over here. So here's 1, this is 2. In fact, I'll just do that. So I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. This is what happens when you do conversions between different programs sometimes. Okay, so basically what you're going to have is in the roof of different areas, you've got a choroid plexus with ependymal cells. So the choroid, which holds ependymal cells, the ependymal cells secrete the cerebral spinal fluid, and that's going to come out here and it's going to go into the lateral ventricle, which is going to flow into the third ventricle, which is going to go down the cerebral aqueduct. Now, there are little apertures in here where it can go out in different directions, but mostly we're focusing on the primary direction. The cerebral aqueduct is going to come down here. Here's the fourth ventricle. Look, you've got more choroid. All right. And then it can go out through these little apertures here, and it can circulate up and go around in this direction, or it can continue to go down this way, down the spinal canal, or it can float around in the subarachnoid space, so it goes kind of in a swirl around the outside of the spinal cord, and it can go back up in this direction. So basically you have it going like this, and you have it going like this. Now you need to get rid of it because you're constantly making it, and if you don't get rid of the cerebral spinal fluid, you're gonna have water in the brain and it hurts. So you've got now the arachnoid villi, which are also called granulations, and they pook out into the arachnoid space, so that the cerebral spinal fluid here can diffuse into the bloodstream here. So this is blood, this is venous blood. So they're not, this isn't open, there's a membrane here, and the cerebral spinal fluid diffuses across the membrane into the subarachnoids, excuse me, not the subarachnoid space, into the venous, into the venous blood in the sinus, all right, into the dural sinus. All right, next slide. Oh, actually, before I go on, this is important. This is a pathway question, which is one of your learning outcomes. You will definitely see, most likely, like 90% sure, you'll see a pathway question on cerebral spinal fluid flow on either a quiz or the final exam. So you should know what this flow is. Don't blow it off on your lab exercises. All right, the previous slide has the notes for meninges. And now we're just going to look at the drawing. And what I want you to notice is I've got skin and hair here. This is going to be fascia, muscle, that kind of stuff. Now I've got the bone. All right, I've got my cortical layer, I've got my diploid layer, and I've got another cortical layer. Now right here, this is the dura mater, okay? And I'm going to divide that into periosteal and meningeal. Periosteal, so osteal, ostium, bone. This layer is right up against the bone, and the meningeal is right up against the other meninges. So you've got the three meninges. You've got dura, arachnoid, and pia, okay? Now, most of the time, the dura mater is really tightly sandwiched together, but in certain areas, these two layers, like right here, are going to separate, and you get a little tunnel that's going to be filled with venous blood. So this is not a vein, but it acts like a vein, and we call this a dural sinus, and because of where this one is located, it gets its own special name, superior sagittal sinus. So these sinuses are created by separating the periosteal and meningeal layers of the dura mater, and then they hold the venous blood. Okay, now the next layer that we're going to look at is the arachnoid matter, and that's this entire section here. Okay, it'll have this membrane, and it has all these little strands that slip down in here. It's also going to be filled with CSF, okay, and you will also see blood vessels in here, all right. And then the arachnoid matter has a special feature called the arachnoid feli. So that means finger, felis means finger. This is also called the arachnoid granulations. So what you'll see is this purple membrane pokes out through the meningeal layer of the dura mater into the dural sinus. So now CSF in here can go out here, diffuse across the membrane, and enter the venous blood. That way you are constantly draining off the cerebral spinal fluid, which you are constantly producing. And it basically just becomes part of the plasma of your bloodstream once it's in that venous blood, okay? And then finally, the last most layer is called pia mater. I'm highlighting it in green, all right? And it basically is a film that clings to the surface, and it dips down into all the sulci of the cortex, okay? Now, I like this picture because it also shows you the gray matter versus the white matter. So you get a nice differentiation between the two. Now, over here, I've got two things, the subdural space and the subarachnoid space. So sub is below dura, so it's below the dura. So it's going to be this space between the dura matter and the arachnoid matter. And then subarachnoid is between the arachnoid and the pia. And this is where you're going to have your CSF. And then finally, we show the meningeal layer dipping down, and we'll actually have it sandwiched together. And it's going to create a special membrane that we call the falx cerebri. All right, next slide. All right, the dura mater in three areas becomes super thick. And we change the name because it has a job dividing up the brain into sections. So I've already mentioned the falx cerebri, which dips into the longitudinal sinus. Now you have the tentorium cerebelli, which is located right here. So the tentorium cerebelli, it's going to separate the cerebrum. Oh, I've already got it over here. The tentorium it's in the transverse fissure, and it's going to separate the cerebrum from the cerebellum. Whereas the falx cerebri separates the right and left hemispheres. All right, and then the falx cerebelli dips down here into the vermis, all right, of the cerebellum, and it basically separates the right and left lobes of the cerebellum. Okay. Now, you noticed up here that I put up a skull. And what I want to point out is you should all be remembering back when we did the skeletal system that you learned the name of that feature. And that feature was called the crista galli. That is a feature on the ethmoid bone. And basically, the fox cerebri attaches right there, and pulling on that bone creates that sharp ridge. Okay? All right, and that was the end of the brain anatomy. So now we will go on the fourth video in this series. On Unit 12, we'll be looking at the models and how to use them for stuttering different features.